everybody. We're glad to see you. We're happy that you're here. I want to remind you, as Sunny did a moment ago, that we have a fellowship meal waiting for you as soon as we're done this morning. And then don't forget also, we won't have evening service tonight like we normally do at 6. We'll meet after we get done eating and unbuttoning our pants. So we're probably about 1:15, 1:30-ish, I would think, probably, as it was the past couple of 5th Sundays we've had. Every 5th Sunday this year, we've been reflecting in our worship on the various acts of worship that we engage in as Christians. And I think it was January, it was our first 5th Sunday, and we studied the first act of worship in this series. That was the Lord's Supper. And we noticed the significance of that meal, and specifically those two emblems, the body and the blood, the bread and the wine, as well as the significance of that night. It was his last supper with his disciples, with his friends, before he would be arrested and beaten and killed. And so we noticed how the broken bread symbolizes his body that was submitted by the will of God for us. His poured out blood represents the poured out drink that we drink, represents his blood that he shed for us as well. And then the last 5th Sunday, I think it was in April, and we noticed the worship act of giving, which is unfortunately kind of a touchy subject for preachers, because I think we're afraid, just to speak on behalf of preachers, and it does happen on occasion, that someone is going to hear a sermon on giving and think, oh, well, he's talking about me. He's trying to step on my toes, and then we'll withhold their contribution, or we'll cut it back, or maybe just leave the church altogether, which would be three very unfortunate reactions to a sermon on giving, since it is a command of God just as much as singing, which we'll study in a moment, or the Lord's Supper, or preaching, or any other thing, or Bible study, or any other thing that we do. But it's sometimes a touchy subject, unfortunately so. But if you remember at that last sermon that we preached in April, I made a challenge to us all to give a little bit more. However much that little bit is dependent on the person and what he wants to give. But for all of us to give just a little bit more, and you'll see what won't happen. You'll see that you won't suddenly go bankrupt, that your bills suddenly won't start piling up, and that you will be taken care of by the God who promises if you give, he'll give to you. And so now we come to our third of, I believe, four 5th Sundays this year. And we're going to consider the worship act of singing. What a blessing we have as Christians to be able to sing. And everybody can do it. Even if you don't do it well, you can still do it. If you have a voice, you can lift that voice up in song. And I never understood the attitude that some people have. And I've heard some say the words, well, I don't like singing, so I don't think I'm going to do it. It's just not for me. I'm not one to sing. And that just befuddles me. You cannot use your inability to sing well as an excuse not to sing at all. I know people, and I am one of them, who has trouble keeping their minds focused, for an example. I don't know about you. Maybe it's not just me. I hope it's not just me. But when I close my eyes and I say my silent prayers to myself, sometimes I catch myself completely off track, thinking about something totally different. I have to stop, refocus, and apologize to God for not getting off track, which I don't know if I need to apologize. I think he understands. My mind wanders. But you might hear that and think, well, you don't pray very good. And you'd be right. I probably don't pray very good. But I still pray because I'm still commanded to pray. So you might use as the excuse, well, I don't sing very good, so I'm not going to sing. It's a poor excuse. You have a voice. Your Father in heaven asks you, requests you, commands you to lift that voice in song. But we ought to want to sing. We should need to sing, not just because it's a command, but for other reasons as well. Why do we sing? We sing, first of all, to glorify God. David writes, Psalm 18:49, I will give thanks to thee, O Lord, among the heathen, that's the Gentiles, or in David's day, his enemies, and I will praise thy name. While he's surrounded by his enemies, he can still find joy and reason to sing. Psalm 47:6, David says, and it's basically the psalm is just two words. Sing praises, O God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. And you can just hear his happiness as he writes those words. Here's one, Psalm 59:16. He says, I will sing of thy power. I will sing aloud of thy mercy in the morning, because you have kept my defense in the day of the trouble. Why did Saul, or Paul, and Silas sing praises when they were in the prison? Acts 16, when they were in the inner prison of Acts 16, in the darkest part of that dungeon, when they were surrounded by rats and who knows what else in that prison cell, and they were chained to the wall, and they had no reason at all to be happy, yet they sang. Why? Because Christians sing. You can't help but sing. Why do we sing? To glorify the God who gave us life. Why do we sing? Number two, we sing for our own benefit. Colossians 3:16, Paul writes, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly with all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Paul says we accomplish two things when we sing. We teach each other and we admonish each other. And so if you're not singing for yourself, if you're not singing for God, at the very least, sing for your brother who is sitting next to you, or your sister in Christ sitting next to you. Why do we sing? Look at those two words he used. He says we sing to teach each other. Consider the song. It's number 496. I'm not going to lead it because I don't lead songs very good. I still sing, but I won't lead. Psalm 496 in your book. It's, oh, listen to our wondrous story. And we're going to flip through and look at a couple of songs. So if you want to get a song with God, you can. We're going to use our Bibles as well, but I thought that was appropriate for this type of topic. But Psalm 496 is, oh, listen to our wondrous story. I love the song. We don't sing it very often. It's a hard song to sing. But basically what you do with the song is you divide it into two parts, two halves, where one group will sing one part, basically asking a question, for example, in the chorus, who saved us from eternal loss? And then the other half will answer the question, who but God's Son upon the cross? What did he do? He died for you. Where is he now? Believe it thou, in heaven interceding. And it goes back and forth like that, where one group sings the question, one group answers the question. And you do that, and you teach each other when you do that. It's very similar. It's probably the closest representation to first century and before kind of singing that they had back then. They didn't break their songs up into bass, alto, tenor, and soprano. What they did was they broke them into parts, and they would take the Psalms written by David and others in the book, and they would chant them. And they would, one half would chant one part, the other half would chant the other part. They would just chant back and forth. And if you ever notice, when you sing something enough times, you memorize it. I probably have more songs memorized than I do Bible verses, because you sing these songs so often, you just know them. And when you hear the tune, suddenly the words just come flooding back to your mind. Singing helps you remember. And so when you sing to each other, what are you doing? You're teaching each other. There's another reason we sing. We sing, Paul writes in Colossians 3:16, to admonish one another. The word means to warn each other. And there are songs that we sing, yes, that praise God, yes, that uplift our voices and uplift our spirits, but there are songs that we sing also to warn each other, to encourage each other to stay faithful, to encourage each other to grow as Christians and to better ourselves in our Christian life. For example, there's a song called There Is a Sea, number 556. I've only heard this song sung one time in my entire life, but the words of the song is what matters. Just how pretty the song is doesn't really matter. If the words are meaningless, if the words are empty, a pretty song is just that. It's just a pretty empty song. But the words in this song, There Is a Sea, mean something. It tells the story of a sea that receives a small amount of water, but grows large and gives a large amount of water. And then of another sea that receives a large amount of water, but gives a very small amount. And it compares those two seas to what kind of faithfulness we have in our giving. For example, listen to the lyrics. There is a sea which day by day receives the rippling rills. The streams that spring from wells of God or fall from cedar hills. But what it thus receives, it gives with glad and sparing hand. A stream more wide with deeper tide flows on to lower land. It receives a little, it gives a lot. But the song continues. There is a sea which day by day receives the fuller tide. But all its store it keeps, doesn't give to shore or sea beside. Its Jordan stream now turned to brine, lies heavy as molten lead. Its dreadful name does e'er proclaim that sea is waste and dead. And you're singing, you don't realize until then, about the Dead Sea that receives the Jordan River but just keeps it. And it stores it until it just turns to salt. And it's worthless because it won't give. And then the song ends. What shall it be for you and me who God's good gifts obtain? Shall we accept for self alone or take and give again? For he who once was rich indeed laid all his glory down, that by his grace our ransom race should share his wealth and crown. And so you sing this song and you teach each other. You sing this song and you warn each other. You sing this song, you admonish each other to stay faithful in all things. Why do we sing? We sing to glorify God. We sing to teach each other, to admonish each other. So now I know why I'm supposed to do it. But tell me what good it is for me. Four things we'll consider, then the sermon's yours. We sing as Christians. If someone asks you, why do you sing, Christian? They see you in a dark, despairing time and they hear you singing. It sounds so contradictory to the circumstances around you, yet they hear you singing. And they ask you the question, why do you sing, Christian? Your answer should be number one. We sing because we've overcome sin. Listen to the lyric. Having overcome sin, hallelujah, amen, will be heard in that land or the phone. You know that song? When all God's singers get home. We'll sing and shout the victory. When all of God's singers get home is the song. I think it's in our book. I'm not sure the number. But we would have no reason as Christians to even want to sing. There would be no reason on this entire planet to want to lift up our voices in excitement and in hallelujah praise were we not saved. If I have nothing to hope for beyond this life, you would not find me singing. You'd find me doing the exact opposite. You'd find me wailing in agony and in misery for the life that I have to live with no hope for the next one. Why do people, in moments of spontaneous excitement, almost involuntarily shout out with excitement? We're 30 days away from college football. Who's counting down with me? What's going to happen when your team scores a touchdown? If it's not like a long, slow march to the end zone with a running play, if it's like a deep pass that suddenly is caught in the end zone, everybody just what? They just jump up. They don't plan to. They don't say, all right, 2 seconds, I'm going to scream. No, it just happens, and then you shout, and you probably scare the dog and wake the child if it's my household, right? You do that involuntarily. You do that without helping it. Why? Because sometimes when you're so filled with excitement, it just has to come out. Christian, why do you sing? Because you've overcome sin, and you're so filled with joy and excitement, you can't help but shout it out. You can't help but exclaim it. And so you just want to shout it to the whole world. You just scream it out. What a Savior, number 329 in your songbook. Once I was straying in sin's dark valley, no hope within could I see. They searched through heaven and found a Savior to save a poor lost soul like me. He left the Father with all his riches, with calmness sweet serene, came down from heaven, gave his life blood to make the vilest sinner clean. And then you just can't help but sing the chorus loud. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, hallelujah. His heart was broken on Calvary. His hands were nail-scarred. His side was riven, being split open. He gave his life blood for even me. Death's chilly waters I'll soon be crossing. His hand will lead me safe over. I'll join the chorus in that great city and sing up there forevermore. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, hallelujah. Can you not just sing it and just, don't you just want to stand and just shout it out? Because when your team scores a touchdown, when you've won, you just want to shout, what a Savior. Though his hands were nail scarred and the side was riven, he gave his life blood for even me. Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because you've overcome sin. Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because times are sometimes tough and you need to get through them. Whoever told you Christianity is easy, whoever told you being a Christian is easy, either isn't a Christian or isn't doing it right. Peter says, 1 Peter 3:17, you're going to suffer. It would be better for you to suffer doing good things for well-doing than doing bad things, evil-doing. But you're going to suffer. Sometime, at some point, someone is going to take issue with something you've done and they're going to attack you for it. Wouldn't you rather they attack you for some good that you've done rather than some bad that you've done? If you're going to do Christianity right, someone's going to take issue with it, and you're going to suffer. And it might be horrible, painful, agonizing suffering, but you can sing your way out of it. The idea of the Christian life being hard, it's not a possibility, it's an inevitability. So make the joy that's within you, that bubbles up and just pours out like song, also inevitable. Someone thinks that's contradictory. Well, why would you sing when you're upset? Well, how else am I going to get happy again, lest I sing? You think, well, I don't feel like singing when I'm upset. There's no songs that I can sing that can cheer me up. You're not hearing the right songs. There's a song that we sometimes sing. It's not in your songbook, unfortunately. It's called Under His Wings. Now, you tell me after you hear these lyrics that they won't lift up a distressed soul. Under His wings I am safely abiding. Though the night deepens and tempests are wild, still I can trust Him. I know He will keep me. He has redeemed me. I am His child. Under His wings, what a refuge from sorrow. How the heart yearningly turned to His rest. Often how earth has balm for my healing. Often when earth has balm for my healing. There I find comfort, and there I am blessed. Under His wings, what a precious enjoyment. There I hide until life's trials are over. Sheltered, protected, no evil can harm me. Resting in Jesus, I'm safe evermore. In the chorus, under His wings, who from His love can sever? Under His wings my soul shall abide, safely forever. Maybe you're just singing the wrong songs. Maybe you can sing a song that will just touch the right nerve. It'll just prick your heart the right way. So though you're surrounded by a cave of distress and disappointment and disillusionment, you can sing just the right song. And like a bird, you'll fly right out of those caves to a happy, joyful experience again. Why do we sing? Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because you've overcome sin. Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because times are sometimes tough and you need to get through them. Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because times are sometimes good and you just can't help but sing. There are times we sing when the mood is somber. Matthew 26:30, Jesus, after He had His last supper, what's on His mind? He's about to die.
Yet he sings a hymn with his best friends, who are moments away from betraying him, Matthew 26:50.
Yet he sings a song with them.
There are songs that we sing, or there are songs, rather, that are written that you can sing, and there were probably some in the first century, that are very somber.
Psalm 22 is David's great cry of distress when he asks God, "Why have you forgotten about me?"
By the end of the psalm, he knows he hasn't been forgotten, but at the beginning of it, he's singing a very somber psalm.
Psalm 13, he says, "How long will you stay away from me and forget me? Forever?"
By the end of the psalm, he knows God's on his side, but at the beginning of it, it's a somber psalm to sing.
But there are more often than not songs that we sing
that we do so because we just can't help it. That something good has happened and it just pours out of us. Exodus 15 starts right after they cross the Red Sea. And what do? They sing a song. Even though 10 minutes ago they were asking God, or they were cursing God and blaming Him for what they thought was about to be their certain death. And then the water splits open. They cross it like dry ground and suddenly they're singing a song.
Why?
Because times sometimes are good and you just want to sing.
There's a song that's not in our books.
We got some songs we need to put in our books.
His Eyes on the Sparrow. Hopefully you know this one.
I love this song. I love this song because I used to sing it wrong, and now I've learned how to sing it correctly. This is a song that we sometimes sing slowly and mournfully and sorrowfully, like it's a depressing ballad. This song is not depressing. This song does not start with the words, "When I feel discouraged," or "When shadows come." The song starts with, "Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely when I long for heaven's home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me. I sing because I'm happy." This is the chorus. This answers the question we're asking. Why do you sing, Christian?
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free of overcome sin.
His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me. That's just what Jesus said when He was talking about how He will care for you, how He will protect you. If God takes care of every single bird that's ever fluttered its wings on this planet, and you are more valuable than a bird, if He takes care of them, you know He takes care of you. His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me. And so the song continues, "Let not your heart be troubled, His tender word I hear. Resting on His goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by the path He leads, but one step I may see. His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when the hope within me dies, I draw the closer to Him. His care, He sets me free. His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me."
Why do you sing, Christian?
I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. If His eyes on the sparrow, I know He watches me.
Why do you sing, Christian?
Because you've overcome sin.
Because times are sometimes bad and you need to get through them.
Because times are sometimes good and you want to celebrate them.
Why do you sing?
Last one and we're done. We sing to warm up our vocal cords for heaven someday.
It's baffling to me, someone who says they don't like singing, you're going to hate heaven.
Because you're going to be doing a lot of singing in heaven. Now, I don't have Bible for that. That's just a good assumption that I might make. Because what is singing? It is praise lifted up to the Father. Well, I'm here and He's there. One day I'm going to be where He is. Am I not going to want to sing?
Certainly I am.
So if you don't like singing, I don't know what to tell you. You better start learning to like it.
If you're a faithful Christian, you're going to be doing a lot of it. Why do we sing?
To warm up now for eternity.
What is it? I do that every time I get up here. It's becoming voluntary.
You clear your throat. The opera singer goes, "Me, me, me, me." Right? Why do they do that?
Because they're trying to get this ready for a big performance.
Well, your singing isn't a performance, but sometimes some of us should be thankful it's not a performance because we don't do it very well.
Your singing isn't a performance, but what you do for 20, 30, 60, 100 years that you're a Christian on this planet is you are just readying those vocal cords.
When you shed this body and you take on a celestial body and you have a divine, a holy throat,
you will sing praises to God forever. Why do you sing?
Because you're saved.
Why do you sing? Because there's no more hardships in heaven.
Why do you sing?
Because you're with God forever.
So sing the wondrous love of Jesus.
Sing His mercy and His grace.
And in those mansions bright and blessed, where He's prepared for us a place, while we walk the pilgrim pathway, clouds will overspread the sky. But when traveling days are over, not a shadow, not a sign. So let us then be true and faithful, trusting, serving every day.
Just one glimpse of Him in glory,
through the toils of life for pay.
Onward to the prize before us, soon His beauty will behold.
Soon the pearly gates will open, and we will tread the streets of gold.
What's the chorus?
When we all get to heaven, What a day of rejoicing that will be when we all get to heaven. We'll sing and shout. You're not going to be quietly murmuring because you're afraid you sing bad, you're going to embarrass yourself. No, you will sing and shout victory. Why do we sing? Why do you sing, Christian? You sing because you've overcome sin. Why do you sing? You sing because times are bad and you want to get through them. Why do you sing? You sing because times are good and you want to celebrate them. Why do you sing? Because you want to clear your voice and get ready to sing for eternity. If you're not a Christian, we're about to sing to you a very special kind of song. It's an invitation song. And though we all sing, it might be that you're halfway through this invitation song and you've been singing it with us, and all of a sudden you stop and you realize your life isn't right with God. All of a sudden you stop and realize they're singing to me. They're singing to encourage me to step out of the aisle and step toward the preacher. He'll take my hand. He'll sit me down and talk with me to make sure that I know what I'm doing, to obey the gospel of Jesus Christ, to believe in Christ, to repent of my sins to Christ, to confess my faith in Christ, and to be immersed into Christ, so that He can take away my sin. And then I have reason to sing as a part of His family. And then one day I'll go home and I'll sing with Him forever and ever. If you're not a Christian, become one. If you're not a faithful Christian, find reason to sing again by repenting and turning back. And you'll find everyone here singing, all the angels in heaven will be singing, and my Father leading them singing praise to God that you've repented. If we can help you in any way, let us know how right now as we stand and sing.